I'm Dr. Sam Yanuck. I'm CEO and Director of Education for Cogent's Immunology. I'm an adjunct assistant professor in the program on integrative medicine in the Department of Physical Medicine and Rehab at the University of North Carolina School of Medicine. And I'm clinic director of the Yanuck Center for Life and Health. We want to talk today about the relationship between brain fog and mast cell activation. So we may tend to think of these as two different things with a sort of a brain domain and a histamine dysregulation domain. But really by the end of the discussion today, I think you'll begin to see pretty clearly that these things are very, very deeply connected. We want to understand the connections. We want to understand how to have leverage in a whole broad range of situations clinically in relation to these two factors that are part of a larger whole. So let's get into it. So in the underlying biology that's driven by these two factors, you'll see really a whole host of different things going on. Brain fog, blood-brain barrier issues, fatigue, anxiety, and depression, all of that seems to be kind of on the brain side. And then on the histamine side, you've got histamine issues, things that you would overtly think of as related to histamine. You have SIBO, leaky gut, chronic inflammation, and presence of chronic viral burdens. Now, an enormous number of people that you'll see in clinical practice have some combination of these things. If you think of this as a laundry list, it's going to be much harder for you. But if you understand the pattern and the map that really undergirds all of this, then you'll just say, oh, this is a different manifestation of the same map, and I know the map. So we'll discuss the map, we'll get into it. So how are these things all related to each other? And what are the key points of intersection? All of that's going to give us leverage, right? If we understand those two key questions, it's going to give us leverage with this whole range of things. Okay, so here's the map. We're going to talk about the map at the beginning, and we're going to talk about it a couple of other times as we go through. So we know that chronic illness and body inflammation are profoundly related to each other, right? They're co-activators. And we know that body inflammation drives brain inflammation. That's well known in the research, and I'll talk about that today as well. So with brain inflammation comes brain fog and fatigue and anxiety and depression. Brain inflammation also drives the chemistry of stress. And stress chemistry drives body inflammation. So right away we have a loop. So a person who's got brain fog, fatigue, anxiety, and depression, and so on, is likely enmeshed in this loop where factors that drive body inflammation are driving their central nervous system inflammation. And that's pumping out stress chemistry, regardless of how stressful their life circumstances are. The body is just doing it. Stress chemistry, as we know, diminishes Th1 cell response. And Th1 cells are required for inhibition of viral illness. And so people who have this configuration tend to have more burden of Epstein-Barr virus, cytomegalovirus, herpes 1, other kinds of viruses. And of course, that drives chronic body inflammation. And so this is a loop, right? And it's a common thing to see clinically. Now, this engine here, this set of loops, drives that loss of Th1 response, which allows then Th2 response to be increased. And Th2 cell activation is going to drive mast cell degranulation. The mast cell degranulation promotes the release of more histamine. Histamine is going to drive this thing called neurogenic inflammation. Now, neurogenic inflammation, we're going to talk about in the whole second half of our discussion. It's a nasty thing. We need to understand it more in the clinical setting and have it be more top of mind when we're thinking about our patients. And by the end of today, you'll be able to do that. Now, neurogenic inflammation turns around and drives more histamine. And neurogenic inflammation is a big driver of GI inflammation. Histamine, meanwhile, is driving leaky gut. Histamine erodes barrier integrity. Leaky gut and neurogenic inflammation both drive GI inflammation. Now we get to a key point, which is that the GI inflammation means that the lining cells, the epithelial lining cells in the GI tract, are going to make these cytokines, IL-33, TSLP, IL-25. And these are Th2 promoting cytokines. That Th2 cell reactivation, of course, reinforces the loss of Th1. So you can see that the loop group on the right is starting to reinforce the group of loops on the left. Meanwhile, the IL-33 and TSLP drive further mast cell degranulation. And this happens whether IgG levels are high or not. In other words, this mast cell degranulation doesn't depend on IgE elevation. And you will see people with plenty of mast cell degranulation and completely normal IgE. So you can't use IgE elevation as a way of understanding whether mast cell degranulation is there. It's going to be there with normal IgE. Now we get to a key point. The mast cells also release mitochondrial DNAs from within the mast cell. These mitochondrial DNAs are highly inflammatory, and they recreate mast cell degranulation. So that's another loop. And the mitochondrial DNAs are profoundly inflammatory in the GI tract, so they drive GI inflammation. You can see how much self-reinforcing loop activation is going on here, right? It's a profound set of loops. No wonder these patients are hard to move the ball on, right? It's hard to get these patients moving in the right direction. Now, this histamine loop drives neurogenic inflammation, as I've said, in relation to GI inflammation, but the same neurogenic inflammation reinforces the brain inflammatory process. And because histamine erodes barrier integrity, that's not just in the intestines, it's also the blood-brain barrier. So now you have histamine reinforcing brain inflammatory issues. Then the brain inflammation means that you don't have as much vagus nerve effective response. The motor control of the vagus nerve, that activation of motor activation for vagus nerve function is diminished. Well, the vagus nerve is in charge of influencing all your organs. And importantly, loss of vagus nerve activation means you'll have more IL-6 production in the liver, more TNF-alpha production in the GI tract and spleen. And because the vagus nerve induces the downgoing peristaltic waves, the motility of the intestine, when you lose that vagus nerve activation, you lose the downgoing peristaltic motility. And so bacteria begin to creep up from the large intestine into the small intestine. And when that happens, you get SIBO. And of course, all of this reinforces the GI inflammation. And all of that GI inflammation and liver and spleen inflammation reinforces body inflammation and takes us back to the beginning there at the top left. So this part is the brain. All of this is about the brain stuff, right? This sort of tan box here. This is all of the histamine stuff. And they reinforce each other's activation. So you can see here why I said at the beginning that the brain component of this and the histamine component of it are really not two separate things. They're part of this broader activation mechanism. Now, all of this tends to drive this other blue box on the left, which is the chronic illness, body inflammation, brain inflammation, loss of Th1, elevation of stress chemistry, viral burdens. The two tan boxes keep all of that locked in. And likewise, they keep the gut dysfunction, the box on the right, the blue one on the right, they keep that locked in. So what we're going to do now is we're going to unpack all of this and show you where your points of leverage are. Now, we want to deal with this brain box. We want to deal with this histamine box. We'll do the brain part first. We'll do the histamine part second. Okay, so neuronal impairment involves neuroinflammation, microglial cell activation, and central nervous system circulation, which is sort of an underappreciated important part of this. Next, we're going to cover the histamine part, and by the time we get to tying together the big picture, you'll already understand all of it. Okay, now, let's talk about the neuronal impairment. First of all, we have neuroinflammation. That's going to give you brain fog. Brain fog is the number one functional medicine patient complaint. Okay. Now, we want to talk about the implications beyond the fog itself, right? We want to talk about how the brain fog tells you about brain inflammation and has implications for neurodegeneration in diseases like Parkinson's and Alzheimer's and so on. And also, we want to talk about implications for central nervous system autoimmunity, right? There's autoimmunity in Parkinson's, MS, other kinds of things like that. PANDAS, of course. Okay. So, and the list goes on. We can talk about lots of other things, but once you understand the principles and understand how to use the map, you'll understand all of it. So, key brain mechanisms. Body inflammation drives brain inflammation, and that drives diminished neuronal signaling. Neuronal signaling means you've got these brain cells that send signals to each other. Those are neurons. And how rapidly the neuron can send those signals is a crucial question. Because if the neurons are too inflamed, then they can't keep making ATP because they're metabolically impaired. Then they can't keep firing rapidly. And the brain is like on a dimmer switch. It starts to go like, you know, and you can't think straight. You have brain fog. You experience that as fatigue and so on. So we want to care about the brain fog. And we want to care about the altered signaling between the neurons, the signaling cells, and these cells called microglial cells. Microglial cells are specialized macrophages, white blood cells, that live in the brain and that take care of the neurons. When they're functioning properly, they reduce inflammation. When they're not functioning properly, it's mischief, and we're going to talk about the mischief. So the altered neuron microglial signaling leads to the loss of neurons because the microglial cells start to eat the neurons. At this point, you should be saying, like, what the heck, right? We don't want in our patients, we don't want microglial cells eating live neurons. That's really not okay. We have to prevent that. But you've got patients in your practice for whom this is happening right now. And the altered neuron microglial signaling leads to brain autoimmunity, which we also have to care about. Okay. So we want to find sources of body inflammation because body inflammation drives brain inflammation. We want to understand how to get in on the conversation between the neurons and the microglial cells, which are those macrophages that live in the brain, to influence that conversation, to get those microglial cells to stop eating neurons, right? We care about brain inflammation. It's going to involve nerve growth factor and BDNF. It's going to involve low neurotransmitter levels. And then the third thing is brain circulation. Because if you can't circulate blood into your brain efficiently, your oxygen level will be low in your brain, glucose will be low in the brain, nutrient status in the brain will be low, and the brain will not thrive. And an enormous number of your patients already have this going on. Okay, so the key point is body inflammation drives brain inflammation. Brain inflammation turns around and drives body inflammation. So I'm going to roll through a bunch of papers that are going to describe that point, but the main take-home message here, don't worry about the details, the main take-home message is if your body's inflamed, it's going to make your brain inflamed. And the microglial cells, these white blood cells, these macrophages, are going to be strongly influenced by that inflammatory process. So here we have microglia and neurodegenerative disease, and they say the microglia are the resident macrophages in the CNS. And if they get activated, like by inflammation or injury or other kinds of things, then they're going to change their phenotype. That phenotype is going to become problematic, that activated phenotype of microglial cells. And diseases with chronic systemic inflammatory components, like Alzheimer's, have a lot more inflammation systemically, right? So patients with Alzheimer's have much more systemic inflammation. And this implies, as the authors say, that there's a crosstalk between systemic inflammation and microglial activation in the central nervous system. Saying the same thing, body inflammation from RA, you have this neuroinflammation, right? In the postmortem brains, the brains are much more inflamed. Why? Because these rheumatoid arthritis patients had inflamed bodies. Now, interleukin-1 beta in the body drives the CNS inflammation. And a single systemic injection of LPS, which is like a gram-negative bacterial damp, damage-associated molecular pattern that the immune system recognizes, right? So when you have a bacterial dysbiosis, the immune system recognizes the LPS. So in this model, they're injecting LPS, and they're finding that you get brain inflammation and changes in microglial cells when you inject LPS into the peritoneum of the body of these animals in this experiment. Okay, now this is about vagus nerve. And the bottom line is that if you have neuroinflammation and you have therefore diminished vagus nerve motor outflow, you're gonna have inflammatory issues and histamine issues down in the body. So this is Frontiers in Immunology. So this is the intestinal lumen, right, at the lamina propria under the lumen. So you see above at the top of the diagram, you see the intestinal brush border, and then below it, now you're into the lining of the intestine. And you have sympathetic and parasympathetic nerves coming down. So these are vagus nerve components, and they interact with the myenteric plexus. And so here, vagus nerve fibers interacting with enteric fibers of that semi-autonomous nervous system, the enteric nervous system, and those neurons release acetylcholine that tells macrophages in the intestinal lamina propria, don't make TNF and do make cytokines that promote regulatory T cells. So the vagus nerve is promoting tolerance in the intestine. Oh my God. So if you want to tolerate your food, your vagus nerve had better work. But if your brain is too inflamed, it won't work. Okay, now here we see the vagus nerve inhibiting interleukin 6 expression in the liver. Interleukin 6 is massively inflammatory, drives Th17 and so on. It's noteworthy also that insulin inhibits vagus nerve activation. So your insulin-resistant patients have a tougher time getting their brain going to stimulate vagus nerve, and then you lose the vagus nerve's inhibitory effects on inflammation in the body. Well, inflammation in the body makes insulin resistance worse, so you can see how that's a loop. Okay, so bottom line, body inflammation, brain inflammation, loss of vagus nerve activation, body inflammation, so you're looped. Now, what about these microglial cells that I've been talking about? So there are these signals that are called on signals and off signals, and the neurons release chemicals that tell the microglial cells, hey, I'm a working neuron, leave me alone. Those are the off signals. Or a dying neuron will release on signals that tell the microglial cells, hey, I'm a dying neuron, come gobble me up. It's very, very important that the neurons be able to signal the microglial cells, hey, I'm dying, gobble me up, because you lose about 10,000 neurons a day. They can't just sit there becoming nasty necrotic tissue. That's going to make the brain a horrible inflammatory mess. So it's crucial that the microglial cells do this phagocytosis of dying neurons. That's crucial to the brain. But it's also crucial that the microglial cells not eat live neurons. Then the question is, how do they know which ones to eat? And that's through these on and off signals that the neurons release into the area around them where these microglial cells are. You got about 10 microglial cells for every neuron. That makes your brain your biggest immune organ by far. If you've got 100 billion neurons to start out, how many microglial cells does that mean you've got? 10 times as many. So your brain is your giant immune organ. Okay, so when the brain cells don't fire rapidly enough, then the microglial cells, which are the brain macrophages, will think that the neurons are dead and will eat the neurons. You should be saying, like, what the heck, right? So let's dig into it. So here are microglial cells. This whole list here across this diagram, these are all macrophages. Notice that right to the left of the microglial cell is an osteoclast. Well, inflammation drives osteoporosis, because it activates these osteoclasts, which are just specialized macrophages. Meanwhile, 13% of all central nervous system white matter are microglial cells, highly, highly represented in the brain. So, during the reparative mode, microglial cells clean up debris and enhance the repair of the damage. And this is an ongoing housekeeping process. It's totally normal. Now, this is a key paper. This is Brown and Nair, Nature Reviews Neuroscience, this is just an amazing paper, microglial phagocytosis of live neurons. And they say, the microglial cells, the brain's professional phagocytes, can remove dead and dying neurons. That's all good. That's like sculpture, right? What's a sculpture? You start out with a big block of granite. It's not a sculpture yet. It's just a big block of granite. You start to chip away at it. So you're subtracting granite. And what emerges is something beautiful and wonderful, which is a sculpture. That's how the brain works too. When you're a baby, you have the most brain cells and the least function. Brain cells start to connect up to each other. The ones that aren't getting involved in the connection start to drop away and die. The microglial cells have to clear them away. Okay, so that's a loss of neurons, but in the same sense that it's creation of a sculpture. What emerges is something beautiful and wonderful, which is your mature adult brain. It's like amazing. And the neurons connect up to each other, and they create a crazy number of synapses, like quadrillions of synapses. So sculpture is just fine. In the healthy brain, these microglial cells, here's how many there are, and they're doing housekeeping. With neurodegeneration, you've got activated microglia that are creating problems. And with neurodegeneration and systemic inflammation, you can see you've got this flood of microglia in the affected areas. So back to our Brown and Nair paper. Microglia can also execute neuronal cell death by phagocytosing stressed but viable neurons. In other words, microglia are munching neurons they shouldn't be munching, and you're never going to get those back. That's ice sculpture, right? We're okay with sculpture. We're okay with clearing dead neurons. But when you start clearing live neurons, then you're melting away the substance of the sculpture. Not okay. So it all comes down to these neuronal on and off signals. So just to be clear, everything on this slide, except for the up and down toggle switches, is the original paper. The up and down toggle switches is just to make the point. So neurons are not passive targets of microglia. They control the microglia through the on signals, hey, I'm dying, come and eat me, and the off signals, hey, I'm a working neuron, leave me alone. The on signals that tell the microglia to eat the neurons are dominated by these inflammatory signals. So the more inflamed the brain is, the more you're tipping the balance toward the on signals. And this is a crucial point because it means that body inflammation, when it drives brain inflammation, tips the balance toward on. And you can imagine, with billions of neurons in the brain and 10 times as many microglia as neurons, the number of surveillance events during each day where a microglial cell looks at a neuron and says, is that a dead neuron? Should I eat that neuron? There are billions of those events every day. And there's an error rate. And what you're trying to do is avoid tipping the error rate toward more mistakes about eating live neurons. That's a fundamental thing. The more inflamed the brain is, the more microglial cells will look at a brain cell and say, well, I'm getting a lot of on signals here. There's a lot of on signals around. I'm going to eat this neuron. You're trying to move the patient away from that. What are the off signals? Off signals include TGF-beta, which is a promoter of tolerance, neurotransmitters. The more a neuron is releasing neurotransmitters, the more obvious it is that it's working and not dead. And then these growth factors, these nerve growth factors. So tolerance from the TGF-beta and the transmitters and these nerve growth factors, all of those are the off signals. So key points, microglia, now we're getting into a new topic, okay? Microglia can present neuronal debris to invading T cells as antigen. And CNS inflammation and low neuronal firing increases the likelihood of this happening. Okay, so this is a paper I published in Frontiers in Psychiatry in 2019, Microglial Phagocytosis of Neurons, Diminishing Neuronal Loss, and you can see it's in a whole variety of contexts. And this is all about the error rate, okay? So here's what you got. You got a neuron. And when neuronal firing rates are high enough, the microglial cell, which is this one, does normal housekeeping functions. And one of those normal housekeeping functions is that when T cells invade the brain, the microglial cell will induce programmed cell death in the T cell. So this is enormously important. Now, neuronal firing rates, if they're too low, or if brain inflammation, and therefore microglial inflammation, is high, then the very same microglial cell is going to express this thing called MHC2. And MHC2 is like the hand with which the microglial cell will hand a fragment of antigen, in other words, neuronal debris in this case, will hand that antigenic fragment to the T cell. And the T cell will accept that handoff using its T cell receptor. So the MHC2 is the hand that the microglial cell uses to hand off the fragment, and the T cell receptor is the hand that the T cell uses to accept the fragment. Now, if this happens, if you've got antigen presentation, and if the T cells aren't being killed, then you have a higher likelihood of autoimmunity. On the other hand, if it's the other way, if neuronal firing rates are high and inflammation rates are low, then you don't get the MHC2 expression on the surface of that microglial cell. It doesn't turn into an antigen-presenting cell. And you have fewer T cells because the microglial cells are killing them. And so you don't get the autoimmunity. So, key targets of concern. Body inflammation, brain inflammation. All right, we talked about that. Altered neuron microglial signaling. So body inflammation drives brain inflammation, and brain inflammation drives on signaling. Low levels of neurotransmitter production drive a loss of the off signals. You got to have the neurotransmitters. And then the loss of nerve growth factors means a loss of another key off signal. What that does is it lets the microglial cells munch the live neurons, and it lets the microglia present antigen to T cells, and that drives CNS autoimmunity. So those are two pretty much unmitigated disasters, right? And of course, all of you have patients in your practice for whom this is happening right now. Okay, so we understand these two things. Now, the third thing is CNS circulation. So what about that? Low oxygen, low glucose, low nutrient status. Neurons can't function if they don't have oxygen or glucose. And of course, nutrient status is crucial too, because neurons, brain cells, are cells. So they participate in the ups and downs of body chemistry, the ups and downs of the implications of poor nutrient status. So now let's talk about CNS circulation. I'm going to roll through these slides not slowly, but the fundamental thing is you'll see a lot of different situations have problems with brain circulation. So the key point is cerebral blood flow is diminished in common things you see in all your patients all the time. So you have reduced cerebral blood flow volume in POTS, even in the absence of orthostasis. It's not just when they stand up and get dizzy. Cerebral blood flow volume is decreased all the time. What about chronic fatigue syndrome? Again, significantly lower global cerebral blood flow. CFS patients as a group have broad decreases in cerebral blood flow. Chronic fatigue syndrome, same thing, another paper. Causes of brain fog. Okay, this is interesting. I'm actually going to violate the rules of giving presentations by reading the slide. So, causes of brain fog and mild cognitive impairment have been investigated. Physiological correlates with orthostatic intolerance in the form of POTS, and again here, decreased cerebral blood flow. And individuals with chronic fatigue may require increased cortical and subcortical brain activation to complete difficult mental tasks. It may take them more activation to get their brains going. Now, same paper, just reading along. Chronic fatigue syndrome patients have demonstrated deficits in the speed and efficiency of information processing, attention, concentration, and working memory. They need more, but they have less. The cognitive impairments are then perceived as exaggerated mental fatigue. They feel it as fatigue. What it is neurons not firing rapidly enough. which we just said, was associated with altered cerebral blood flow. And here they say it again. As a whole, this is experienced by those with chronic fatigue as brain fog and may be viewed as the interaction of physiological, cognitive, and perceptual factors. The cognitive symptoms of chronic fatigue may be due to altered cerebral blood flow activation and regulation that is perceived as fatigue and experienced as brain fog. Now, the point of this slide is simply this. A lot of papers talk about altered blood flow in post-concussion. Okay, so your people who have had head injuries, if that's part of their history, you have to be concerned about diminished cerebral blood flow. So, body inflammation, brain inflammation, altered neuron microglial signaling, and CNS circulation with low oxygen, glucose, and nutrient status, what we understand now is cerebral blood flow is a big piece of it when you have brain fog, when you have CFS or other manifestations of fatigue, when you have POTS, or when you've had a concussion, TBI. Okay, so blood flow, growth factors, neurotransmitters, all inhibited by inflammation and by histamine. Now we're into the second part of the conversation. We're going to talk about histamine. So the histamine response. So we saw our map. We're going to revisit it very briefly here. Th2 dominance, mast cell degranulation driving histamine, driving neurogenic inflammation. In this second half, we're going to talk about neurogenic inflammation. It'll blow your mind. It's very important. And you'll say to yourself, how did I not know this already? How is it possible to have been in practice all these years without having that front and center for me? Now, the histamine drives leaky gut, like we talked about. That plus neurogenic inflammation drives the GI inflammation. The epithelia make these cytokines that drive Th2, that drive mast cells. The mast cells make the mitochondrial DNAs that further drive the mast cells and that drive the GI inflammation. And that loop is what we're going to talk about now, this whole box. Okay, histamine in the brain, the main point is there's a lot of complexity to the discussion about histamine in the brain, but we want to talk about the two really key clinical things that are clear and consistent across patients. And they are that histamine drives neurogenic inflammation and drives barrier breakdown. Histamine drives consistent blood-brain barrier opening, one of the few CNS neurotransmitters found to do this. So, mast cells create proteases, create histamine, drive inflammatory cytokine activation, and all of this drives epithelial permeability, barrier breakdown. Guts, lungs, sinuses, blood-brain barrier. The vaginal tract, for that matter, as well. Now, we're going to unpack this paper, the role of histamine in neurogenic inflammation. So, this is what neurogenic inflammation is. You got a mast cell. It's going to release a bunch of histamine. There are receptors for histamine on the mast cell. So that's a self-reinforcing autocrine loop right away. When the mast cells release histamine, it drives more mast cell histamine release. And there are histamine receptors, again, all four types, on that sensory neuron. So mast cells are in juxtaposition. They're right next to sensory nerve endings in a lot of tissues. And this has to do with pain, it turns out, as well, because these are sensory neurons. Now, when the sensory neuron gets stimulation from histamine, it's going to release CGRP, substance P, and vasoactive intestinal polypeptide, VIP. And there are receptors for all three on the mast cell. That NK1 receptor is a substance P receptor. Now, CGRP, it's noteworthy, drives edema. So you know how you have these patients who, when they get histaminic, their legs swell up? That's CGRP. CGRP also drives migraine. Substance P drives pain. All of these actually all these drive pain. But substance P is sort of the professional driver of pain. And vasoactive intestinal polypeptide, VIP, also drives innate lymphoid cells type 2, ILC2s. They are part of the Th2 response. So in neurogenic inflammation, when you get the substance P and CGRP released from neurons, it induces the release of histamine from mast cells. In turn, the histamine evokes the release of substance P and CGRP. The VIP is in there as well, as you can see from the diagram. Now, this happens in injury. Same thing we just described. Okay, same, same. Now, noteworthy that injury doesn't have to mean, you know, getting smashed into in a car or something. Injury can just mean tissue chronic inflammation. That's an injury effect, right? Skin, same thing. Histamine released from mast cells in the skin. Drive sensory neurons to release substance P and CGRP. Same thing. So these skin disorders, lung and sinuses, same, same. Substance P, CGRP, notice they mention the vasodilation and edema, and this is involved with nasal obstructions in the, you know, blocked sinuses and bronchoconstriction in the lower airways, also mucus secretion and inflammatory cell recruitment. What about the bladder and interstitial cystitis, painful bladder syndrome? Same thing. Mast cells play an important role. Substance P, mediated mast cell activation, and so on. Very same thing, involvement with pelvic pain as well. What about migraine? This is a different paper now. Low CGRP gives you the brain on the left. High CGRP gives you the migraine brain on the right. And you probably know that there's a new class of migraine medications that are CGRP inhibitors, like Aimovig. Now, different paper. Patients with IBS, it's going to be the same thing. And functional dyspepsia, it's going to be a similar thing, but involving eosinophils. So let's look at that. This is a kind of an amazing paper. Let's blow up the diagram and look at it. So you have Th2 cells in the intestine, right? Intestinal inflammation drives Th2 dominance. The Th2 cells make interleukin-5 that drives eosinophils. The Th2 cells make IL-4 that drives mast cell histamine release. The histamine and the eosinophil granule proteins irritate the enteric nervous system neurons in a way that signals the brain. Meanwhile, the chemistry of stress, you can't quite see it, but stress chemistry is behind my face there. It's going to be IL-1 beta, TNF-alpha, and IL-6. And that's going to drive activation of the brain, inflammatory activation. The brain's going to have a stress response as a consequence. And it's going to drive the enteric neurons to stimulate M2 macrophages and stimulate Th2 cells. So you can see this is a loop between the GI dysregulation-induced Th2 response that drives the eosinophils and drives the mast cells to create these irritating chemicals, the histamine and the eosinophil granule proteins, that irritate the enteric neurons that drive the brain. Meanwhile, because the lining of the intestine, those epithelial cells, because they also make NF-kappa-B, they're going to drive systemic inflammation. Those cytokines make the brain inflamed. So you have this double loop activation going up to the brain then releasing stress chemicals that drive Th2 and M2 max. M2 max, of course, are part of the Th2 response. Now, what chemicals are involved there? Well, it's noradrenaline, also called norepinephrine. So you have an enteric neuron releasing noradrenaline, norepinephrine, to stimulate that Th2 cell. And likewise, here you have the same noradrenaline here with that enteric neuron driving the M2 MAC. Now, so you have a Th2 dominance-based drive of mast cell activation, releasing histamine, driving neurogenic inflammation, which drives more histamine, and drives GI inflammation, and those epithelial cells make those cytokines, reinforcing the tissue dominance, reinforcing the mast cells. The mitochondrial DNAs get released, which further drive the mast cells, and you have more GI inflammation. But it's not just in the GI tract. It's in all of those target tissues that I just rolled through there in that part of the discussion. So this same set of loops is going on in the lungs, in the sinuses, in the bladder, in the skin, and so on. Same loop. Now, it's important to notice that IgE and mast cells aren't always in lockstep. You can have chronic allergic inflammation and other settings involving both, but mast cells don't necessarily have to have IgE along for the ride. A lot of things can drive mast cell activation. We've been talking a lot about TSLP and IL-33 because epithelial tissues make them. What's also true, though, is exogenous agents like bacterial toxins, like, you know, the LPS we talked about, can also drive mast cell histamine release. Now, so patients with mast cell issues don't always have high IgE. So here you have intestinal epithelia making IL-25, IL-33, and CSLP, and the IL-33 and CSLP drive the mast cell degranulation. Okay, now, in asthma, you see the same thing. It's just in the lungs, but you see the same cast of characters. Now we got to talk about these mitochondrial DNAs. So in inflammatory bowel disease, mitochondrial DNAs stir up inflammatory activation. They are pro-inflammatory damps, okay? And they're increased in ulcerative colitis and in Crohn's disease. But that's not the only place they're increased. When mast cells degranulate, they release these mitochondrial DNAs, and the mitochondrial DNAs then re-stimulate the mast cells. That's that loop I've been talking about. So it's crucial then to break down these mitochondrial DNAs, right? These are proteins. You need something that is proteolytic to break those down. Okay, now it's going to drive the same, you know, you're going to drive the whole set of loops, right, through the mitochondrial DNAs. So it's going to be very useful to get rid of those. Okay, now, no discussion of histamine would be complete without a slide like this, just talking about the different kinds of histamine receptors. You can see H1, H2, H3, H4. The different kinds of histamine receptors are involved in the different components of the way that histamine affects all of these different tissue targets. And then likewise, no discussion will be complete without a discussion of low histamine diets. And you can research that on your own. But the gist of it is that in these kinds of patients, sometimes a low histamine diet is very suitable. It doesn't have to be black and white. It's about lowering the total histamine burden, getting it low enough that you're within what they can handle in terms of clearance. Now, very interesting paper, reiterating what we've talked about so far. Here you have a dendritic cell, and it's going to reach its dendrite up between epithelial cells of the intestinal lining. The crucial point here is the person doesn't need to have leaky gut for that dendritic cell to be sampling what's in the lumen. Everybody thinks that you have to have a leaky gut in order to have reactions to food. Well, no. You have to have a poor tolerance and the ability to sample, and the ability to sample is ongoing. So these dendritic cells sample antigenic fragments and present them to Th2 cells as antigen. Meanwhile, the intestinal lining is making IL-25, IL-33, and TSLP, like we've been talking about. One of the functions of those is to promote innate lymphoid cells type 2, which are part of the Th2 system. Those ILC2s and the Th2 cells, they both make a whole bunch of these Th2 cytokines, which drives the eosinophils and the mast cells and the M2 macrophages, and drives B cells to make IgE, only if they do, they don't necessarily have to. And of course, in this slide also, you see here a Th1 cell in a reciprocal inhibition relationship with the Th2 cell, as most of you are accustomed to seeing by now. So, histamine regulation in the body, how do you do it? Well, make less histamine, clear it from the system faster, modulate the overabundant Th2 response. Now, the body making less histamine involves normal mast cell function so that those loops are not in play, and it involves normal breakdown of the mitochondrial DNAs through proteolytic activation, so those mitochondrial DNAs don't re-stimulate the mast cells. And it's crucial that the body be able to clear histamine from the system. Now that involves DAO, which everyone knows about, and also involves aldehyde dehydrogenase. Now clinically speaking, low DAO is much less often a problem than diminished aldehyde dehydrogenase activation. Aldehyde dehydrogenase is involved in histamine clearance, and it's involved in the clearance of aldehydes. Well, where are the aldehydes from? Well, sugar ferments to alcohol. Alcohol ferments to aldehydes. Most perfumes are aldehyde-based. You know how patients can't tolerate perfumes, but every so often there's a perfume they can tolerate? That's a perfume that doesn't have aldehydes in it. Molds off-gas aldehydes. Building materials off-gas aldehydes. So any patient who's got a problem with any of those kinds of things is likely to have diminished aldehyde dehydrogenase integrity. Or even simply, a patient who is having trouble clearing histamine is likely to have a problem with aldehyde dehydrogenase integrity. So here we have histamine, and we've got two cascades by which it can be cleared. Here's histamine N-methyltransferase. HNMT requires SAMe. Occasionally you'll see a patient who needs to have SAMe as part of their ability to... Now, this is the histamine clearance cascade. So here's the histamine. You have two branches. On the right, you start with histamine N-methyltransferase, and that requires a methyl group donation from a chemical like S-adenosylmethionine, for example. On the left side, you start with DAO, diamine oxidase. Now, on the right side, you also have a need for DAO, but notice also that both cascades require aldehyde dehydrogenase. Now, the cofactors biochemically for aldehyde dehydrogenase are B2, B3, iron, and molybdenum. So, here's the big picture. Just like we've talked about before, chronic illness drives body inflammation and vice versa. Body inflammation drives brain inflammation. We talked about the implications there. Stress chemistry driving body inflammation, loss of Th1 and how that allows viral burdens to expand and push body inflammation. We talked about that cycle. Then we talked about how that gets us into the series of cascading effects through neurogenic inflammation. We talked about histamine driving leaky gut, which also drives GI inflammation. We talked about the epithelial effects, pushing Th2 dominance, reinforcing loss of Th1, driving mast cell degranulation, driving mitochondrial DNA release that reinforces the mast cell granulation. We talked about the mitochondrial DNAs reinforcing the GI inflammation and how all of that is a loop that's so entrenched. Then, because histamine drives neurogenic inflammation, it's going to drive, therefore, the brain inflammation reinforcement. And, of course, histamine erodes barrier integrity, so you're going to have blood-brain barrier compromise as well. All of that is going to reinforce the brain side of the equation. Then, brain inflammation means less vagus activation, which means you're going to have more IL-6 in the liver, TNF in the GI tract and spleen. You're going to have less gut motility. It's going to give you SIBO. You're going to end up with more GI inflammation. And all of that is going to drive more body inflammation. So we have the brain side. We have the histamine side. And they are looped together. And so now you understand this map. You understand the implications across a broad, broad range of clinical manifestations. Okay, now let's talk about supplementation. So the first thing is brain reset. And brain reset is designed to promote concentration and memory with multifaceted support for a healthy blood flow. Healthy blood flow, immune-mediated production, neuroprotection, and cognitive function. Promotes concentration, mental clarity, and memory associated with brain fog. Promotes neuroimmune health by supporting cellular function, neuroprotection, immune-mediator balance. And in vitro and animal research suggests that lion's mane, one of the ingredients, promotes neuronal health by supporting nerve growth factor synthesis. Okay. Here are the ingredients. Lion's mane mushroom, very healthy dose. Bacopa, a very, very cool form of ginkgo. This is crazy cool. Ginkgo phosphatidylserine phytosome in a sunflower phospholipid complex. Wow, okay, that's cool. And then butcher's broom, feverfew, and luteolin. Okay, I'm very excited about this. And then history set. So, within the body, most histamine comes from mast cells that have been activated. We talked about this. Maintaining healthy mast cell integrity can support healthy histamine balance in the respiratory tract, brain, other tissues. Ingredients, vitamin C, like you would expect. B2, B3, and molybdenum, as we discussed before. Cysteine, quercetin, luteolin, and rutin, and bromelain, which is a proteolytic enzyme. Okay, this is very cool stuff. Now, if you want to dive deeper, if you want to get more into how these things work, how this underlying immunology works overall, you can join Cogence Immunology. It's a member community that has about 5,500 clinicians in it and growing from all around the world. Pure Encapsulation sponsors your membership, so it doesn't cost you anything to join. You can go to cogenceimmunology.com and look there. That's the visitor website. It'll tell you everything about how to join. It's very easy to do. It's a self-paced course, so you just watch the videos on your own. There's a weekly Q&A webinar you can join. It's a Q&A forum. You can ask questions there. It's a rather lively community, so I encourage you to join. Okay, thanks for your attention.